Hey guys, John, Rocket TV 1 here. Third week of April 2019, and I am going to answer some questions about my SELKIRK SUPERVENT double wall insulated flue pipe install. The warranty on this pipe, I believe, is about 10 years, and so I am halfway there, and it shows, other than some weather discoloration, it shows no signs of use inside and out. I have been cleaning this. I started out looking at it three times a season when I first put it up because, hey, it was new to me, and I had to know whether how that was going to work. And after being on the roof three times a year, I decided once a year was the way it's been going. And so I usually, if I have something else to do, like Christmas lights, I will check it at the beginning of the season there. And I usually check it again before I go in and start using it, which may be around September or October or whatever. So let's get to some of the questions that I have here. Okay, the one question I have is, what about the brackets that I've made? Okay, question number one. What about the wall brackets, the brackets that are holding this to the concrete? Well, this is what they sell you right here. And they're too small for this. And that was the reason why I made this. The way I wanted to make this was so that it did not kink around my overhang. And these, as you can see here, I don't know if we're seeing this here in the photo. Okay, so if you can see this here in the picture, these are triangular, and they have all the holes on the top for the base plate, for the T-pipe. SELKIRK says on the outside install, which is what this is, you can theoretically run this through the center of your house and up through the floors and up through the roof, and that or out through the wall of your living room or bedroom or whatever, and that's why they call it the through the wall kit. I, however, you buy the kit, you get the elbow and the angles, which these are 30 degree angles. This bracket goes here against the concrete. Now if I was to show you, so maybe you can notice the difference in size here and ruggedness. This is like 1/8, 3/16 bed frame steel. Guys have said, well, all that bed frame steel is weak. Really trying to drill a hole in that and see how weak it is. Yeah, so the flue pipe would be technically in the center of that. So you could see how much distance I got there. That distance is going to be the 12 inches of my overhang on the roof and the 2 inches away from my shingles, which is what you have. 2 inches away from any combustible materials all the way to the cap. So that's what that is. So there you is, about the center, about 14 from center. That's why I made these brackets. That overhang on the roof, you have to have that 2-inch gap up there. There has to be 2 inches right there. Has to be. That's fire code, 2 inches everywhere. Now, SELKIRK says that they want no kinks in an outside installation. That's what this is. The professionals said, oh, we jog out around that. Well, no, that's only for interior, and the reason they allow it on an interior is because the temperature of the pipe will be hot enough to keep creosote from building up in the angles. That's why they allow you to do that on an internal install, or yeah, indoor install. On an outdoor install, you cannot do that. That's it's just not what it is. Well, the fire chief may not know, and the insurance guy may not know. SELKIRK knows, and they won't insure the pipe. This another fact is I'm pretty certain that it's been 6 years now since I read the spec sheet on this pipe. But they guarantee this pipe to take a full-on chimney fire for hours. It's rated for hours at full-bore chimney fire temp, whatever that turns into. Something just under stainless melting temperature, which is 2,800 degrees or something like this. A fire could burn in there for 2,800 degrees for hours before it becomes a problem. That's not to say that if you're too close anywhere, that will hurt your house, because it might definitely do that. But that's why this pipe, this brackets, did not get used. Okay, another question is, how about the bracketry that we have here? The standoffs is what I'm going to call them. And this is a standoff right here. And that standoff, in its factory functionality, would be against the wall, screwed to the wall. There's 16 inches between that screw and the screw over here. And that would be between the studs on the wall. And if that wasn't bent like that, that would allow you the 2 inches right here. 2 inches would be from your wall to the pipe. That is what is recommended. However, I personally didn't like that for a vinyl siding house. It's after 6 years of watching it, it's probably enough, but I didn't like it. And I needed something to hold the pipe my 1 foot out. So I mounted these here. This is banding. Galvanized banding. It's like 80 thousandths. And I just hooked it into a hoop and then made me break on the studs. Those are, there's 1, 2, 3 in between there. And so there is the distance that I need, plus the 2 to get me away from the roof overhang. Okay, so now you can see that. There's another question. Why didn't I buy the hammer drill? Well, I did. However, the part two number video came out before I had the drill. And the drill is the SDS hammer drill from Harbor Freight. And that video is right here. Okay, so why did I not want those kinks? Well, I didn't want the kinks because imagine trying to run your chimney sweep rig down through there. And I own my own chimney sweep rig. I actually had it before I got this. And it is, this pipe is, I believe it is 7 inches internal, like a regular standard flue pipe, so that it mates up with regular standard 7-inch flue pipe internally. And then the external diameter is 9 inches because it's an inch of insulation all the way around, therefore 9. And so I own the fiberglass screwed together poles with a 7-inch steel brush. Now, because this is stainless steel inside and out, they tell you you should be using a plastic brush. Well, I already owned mine, and it was a 10-year warranty on this chimney. And that's why I'm saying if you burn the stove right and you have it right, you likely only need to check this once or twice a year. You should probably check it for birds and critters every fall. And then, and at the same time, give it the sweep. I prefer to burn a real hot wood fire in here towards the end of the year to clean the pipe. That way there's nothing left in it because of the condensate and the moisture over the summertime just sitting around. So that is that. Okay, another question was about the locking bands. And the locking bands are just basically a strip of stainless steel with a bolt and a nut on them. And they go at the intersection of every section, or every 2 feet, I believe these are. These 2 feet? No, these are 30, these are, 36 total. And the band would go at every intersection of 36 inches. That is to keep them supposedly from unscrewing. However, Lowe's, the day I bought this, did not have the bands in stock. They sell them separate, they don't come with the kit. As a matter of fact, all that does come with the kit is the brackets, the wall brackets, the base plate, the T-pipe, two of the 30 degrees, and the wall thimble, which is the big wall thimble that fits you in between studs of your framing studs. So they did not have these at Lowe's. I kind of figured that after taking it apart and looking at it, that it is about a quarter of a turn, maybe a shad less, to unlock these. They lock. There's little pip marks corresponding on the female and the male sides of this, and you turn them and it locks them together. So barring some act of God and some sort of harmonic vibration set up by, I don't know, the windy side of your building, probably the weight of that is going to hold it together. And the only part that may be susceptible to anything would be the very most top section. However, mine, that very top section is bracketed to the roof, so it will not turn anyway. So in theory, unless you had some sort of harmonic vibration going on in the wind, like a guy wire off your old TV antenna or your ham radio antenna, this is not going to unturn. So I saw no real need for the locking bands. And my wall brackets are spaced, I forget what they said it was, but I think it is 1, 2, 3. Yeah, no more than 3 sections, and I am right at 3 sections on there. I just didn't figure I needed any more. It was divided by 3. I got one on the roof, two-thirds, and one at one-third, and the rest is at the bottom. So I just figured I had plenty holding that there. Okay, somebody else said, well, there was another question. How come I ran the T upside down or backwards? Well, you can't run the T upside down and backwards. One side of the T has the fitting for the pipe, so you can't really run it upside down. The other part of this pipe, it has a screw-in cap, which I'm not going to take off of there right now, but the screw-in cap goes up in there. So if you consider the fact that I have that one 30-degree elbow, so it's nearly a straight shot into this pipe, and if they had it from the wall, from your wood stove in your living room or something, they show you a picture of it straight into the building. So really, I've lost nothing. As a matter of fact, I've gained on the amount of initial draft I can get out of this because it's here. Another question, well, how hot does it get? Let me say that it's running right now, and it's probably 55 degrees out today, and I can put my hand on here. If I had a roaring wood fire, 700-800 degree firebox, and 500-600 degree flue pipe, single wall flue pipe coming out of the stove, this pipe would definitely be warm to the touch. However, on a 0-degree day outside, it doesn't matter. And like I said, I do not have creosote built up because I use that old Army cannon heater stove, and that thing, it burns properly. Not like one of those smoldering EPA California wood stoves. Pretty glass on it, but it does nothing but smolder. It certainly doesn't heat your house. Thanks for watching, you guys. John Rocket TV once said that. Any more questions, I'll try to answer them for you.